Hello, good afternoon. This is the Bishop's Desk. I pray that you are having a great day. Just want to say that I missed you on last week. I hope that God has been answering your prayers and hope that everyone is well. It's good to be back here at the Bishop's Desk to learn more of Jesus. This is a space where God has given us to be able to search the scriptures and to be able to grow thereby. And so I'm honored and I'm grateful that God has allowed us to have this time just to be able to learn more of him, because there are far and few spaces in the world today, minus all the distractions. There are so many distractions in the world today that sometimes it is just so hard to be able to find like-minded people that desires to learn the word of God, again, without all the antics and without all the other stuff, just the word of God. And so we thank God for giving us this space with a camera and the Bible to be able to learn more of him. And so I'm totally grateful and honored for what God is doing in this space, and just how much I have learned myself sharing the word of God with you. It has been a blessing to me. And so we want to open up with a brief devotions. We do not own the rights to any of this music. We do not own the rights to this music. We're going to play about a minute or two of the devotions, and we're going to go into the word of God. I thank and praise God. There's a mother that she thinks about me from time to time, and she will send me songs to encourage me. And so she sent this one to me, and I just want to share it with you. I just felt like it was just like so on point. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. Oh yes. Man, he hitting that horn. Mm-hmm. falling in love with Jesus. How profound is that? It's the best thing, the songwriter says, that I've ever done. And when I opened it up and listened to it, it just spoke to my entire life. And that's many of us. That's many of us. Because we all have a testimony. We all have life experiences. No one experience in one person's life is greater than experience in another person's life. They all are valuable. And falling in love with Jesus was the best thing that we could have ever done after the experiences that we went through in our life. And now that we are following Christ, learning, and when we go into Peter, where we are right now, 1 Peter chapter 1, we're gonna be around verse 5 and 6, where 5, 6, and 7, I'm sorry, where Peter talks about us perfecting, growing, maturing. This word perfecting just means maturing, because we know there was only one perfect one, but there are things that we can mature in our spiritual life. That's why the Bible tells us to move unto perfection through our experiences. We can only move unto perfection. We can only mature through our experiences in life. And so in verses 5, not more so 5, because 5 really talks about, let's make it clear, that we're only kept by the power of God. The word of God is going to always turn you back to giving glory and honor to God, taking any credit from the flesh, giving all credit to the Spirit. And so that's what we talk about in verse 5, giving all praise and honor to Christ Jesus, to God through Christ Jesus for us. I say it that way because all blessings come from God, but they come to the Gentile, right? And even to the Jew now, all blessings flow from God through Christ. And so it is only through God accepting us that we are kept. It's not like we get up in the morning and we say, oh, I don't want to sin. Oh, I don't want to do wrong. Oh, I want to do everything right. Our flesh don't wake up like that. It is the power of God in us. It is the new man in us that persuades us when we wake up, I don't want to sin today. When we wake up, God, forgive me for the sin that I've committed. That's the new man. That is the Spirit of God in you that you have submitted to, that allow you to have that mindset. It is the power of God that gives you the power to choose that mindset. And so that's in verse 5. And so it all goes back. It says, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation. We believe in Jesus Christ. So it is the power of our belief through our faith that is going to hold us in that train of thinking, in that mindset until salvation returns. Jesus returns. Okay. But in verse 6 and 7, as we go into the word of God, he's beginning in these two verses to address us about maturing and using the trials of your life, using the problems in your life, taking the bad and making it work for your good. Because oftentimes the normal person, the immature Christian, the Christian who has not grown in the word of God, because there's a difference. You can read the word of God, right? every day. And there will come a level of maturity just through your reading, just through your knowledge. But then to the believer that reads the word of God and then begin to identify themselves in the word of God and then make the necessary adjustments in their life, that their life will begin to line up with the word of God. That's when you begin to move unto perfection, maturity in the word of God. And that only comes through life experiences. And so he begins to, in verse 3 and 4, he talks about the perfection growing up, but through your faith, right? He says, for perfection of faith through sufferings. Everybody wants to run from problems. Nobody wants problems. You have some people that exist in the world today, and they are somewhat deceived, because you have some people that want to live their life every day peacefully. That is so far from a truth. You cannot live your life every day peacefully. You're going to be faced with confrontation. You're going to have crossroads in your life where you're going to have to make tough decisions. You're going to have to make decisions in your life where everybody is not going to agree with the decisions that you make. But again, it goes back to moving unto perfection, mature, making the right decisions in your life, and being okay with that, and standing on that, because you know that the decision you made, it was right. And not only right, because here's where the fine line is drawn for the believer. The decision that you make in your life, can you find it in the word of God? Under righteousness, because everything that happens in life can be found in the word of God. Because the word of God, it is a book of life that has already taken place and that is taking place now. It covers what happened then and is covering what happens now, and it's covered to the point of knowledge that God wanted to be revealed unto man what's going to happen in the future. But we know that it has not been fully revealed the future, because the Bible clearly tells us that the Bibles couldn't contain it all. Two, it has not entered into the minds of man the things that God has prepared for him in the eternal, in the future. So we know that it was up into a point where God cut off the knowledge for man. What he put in the word was what he wanted us to know. What he put in the word would keep us unto the coming of Christ. We know that Christ is going to come. We see that in the word of God, that he's going to return. Look at 1 Peter 1 and 13. So he says, gird up the loins of your mind. Prepare yourself. 1 Peter 1 and 13. We know that Christ has returned. So he says, gird up, prepare yourself. Hey, Google, what's the definition of gird?
Here's the definition of gird. Short for gastroesophageal reflux disease.
Hey, Google, what's the meaning of gird up?
On the website Merriam-Webster.com, they say, transitive verb, 1, to prepare for action. To find out more, look for the link in your Google Home or Google Assistant app.
To prepare for action. To get ready. gird up, to prepare yourself for. He says, gird up the loins of your mind. Get your mind ready. The thoughts of your mind, get them ready. He says, be sober, clear-minded. Be sober, not confused about if Jesus is going to come. Am I really serving the right God? Did he die for me? Do the research of that now. Follow the instructions of the word now so that when Christ comes, you are sure, sober-minded, you are clear. The thoughts of about Christ returning, you are clear on that. So he says, prepare yourself. Be clear on what you believe and your faith, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you. The grace that is to be brought unto you, the believer, right? At the revelation, the appearance of Jesus Christ. When something is revealed, it is shown. It shows up at the revelation of Christ, which means Christ is going to return. He's going to come back. And so when he comes back, he's looking for those believers who are clear on what they've been believing, and they are prepared because they prepared themselves to be received by Jesus Christ. And so here Peter, in verse 6 we looked at last week, he says, wherein ye greatly rejoice. We rejoice in the fact that we don't have to stay here forever. That there is a place in the eternal after we die and leave this place, that we're not just going to be shoved into a coffin box, put into the earth to be no more. He says, so wherein we greatly rejoice, that the graveyard is not the end of me. Because just think about it. When we look at the graveyard and we look at the tombs and we look at death, if that is the end, that is sorrow. That's sorrow. But he says, wherein we greatly rejoice, because we know that the graveyard is not our end. There's a hope in us, the hope of glory, Jesus Christ, the Holy Ghost that is in us. God himself is in us. And so the spirit that's in us, it causes us to greatly rejoice. Even though now for a season, in this season that we're in right now, right? If need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations. Even though we understand that while being absent from God, we desire to be accepted of God. Even though being absent from God, we greatly rejoice because we know that he has prepared a home for us in the eternal with him, not in the graveyard. Not in the tomb. That's not my last stop. But my last stop is with God in the eternal. So we greatly rejoice. But for this season of our existence, sometimes we are heavy, right? We're heavy with different temptations. Different things come. Manifold temptations. Different temptations. They come to try you. They have been designed to try you. To see if your faith is sure, if your faith is anchored in the anchor, which is Christ Jesus. Because he is the anchor of our faith, our salvation. Jesus is. Let me see, they had another song, but I don't want another song. Let me see what, we'll see, go to Hebrews 6 and 19. See what that say. See what Hebrews 6, chapter 6, verse 19 says. It says, which hope we have as, which hope we have as anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. Let me see. That's not the scripture that I want. That by two imputable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Let me see. That's not what I want. Christ is the anchor. It's taking me back to Hebrews 6 and 19. I don't know, I'm gonna outlook. But anyway, Jesus being the anchor of our soul, we are anchored in Jesus Christ. Our belief, our faith is anchored in Jesus Christ. It is grounded. When you anchor something, you ground it. It holds. And Jesus being the anchor of our faith, holding our faith because we have submitted unto him in his way. So once we submit unto his way, right? So you take a ship, right? Take a ship. The ship, he drops his anchor. He drops his anchor from the ship into the ground. And the anchor holds it, it hits the bottom of the sea and it holds the ship there. So Christ being our anchor, he becomes our anchor because we follow his commandments, his word, which is sure, which will never pass away, his word. And so Christ being the anchor, because we follow him, he holds us, Christ holds us in his word through our faith. If that makes sense to you. Christ being our anchor, we're following because we all have a choice. We're following the instructions, being obedient, following his commandments. He says those that love me, that'll be a part of me, they will follow and keep my commandments. So we follow and we keep his commandments. So he becomes the anchor. In other words, it is him, because of our obedience, that holds us in him, his word, through our obedience, through our own choice of serving him, being obedient unto him. So he becomes sure, a sure anchor that holds us, right? Even when we go through trials and tribulations in our life that come like a storm to push us away from that anchored space. Because see, the anchor holds you so that you're not tossed and you're not driven into a place where you maybe can't come back from, or a place of being dangerous. So the anchor holds you there until the storm passed by. Life as we know it delivers problems to us in our life. So if we use the analogy of a storm coming, the problems of life, the challenges of life would represent the storm. They come and they go. But Christ being our anchor holds us sure and firm in his word. So it's necessary, though, that the storms come to try us, to see if our anchor is sure and that it will hold. Now, we know the anchor is sure because the anchor is Christ. We know the anchor will hold because the anchor is Christ. But what happens is, will we continue to follow his commandments that the anchor remains sure? Because we following his commandments is what allow him to be sure in us, because he's sure regardless. But in your life, will he be sure? And he can remain sure in your life only through following his commandments, right? So these manifold temptations, these different trials, these different temptations, these different attacks on the believer that come our way, they come for a season. They come for a purpose, right? They come for a season. They come and they go. But when they come with a purpose. There's a purpose why God allows the manifold temptations to get close to you and to trouble you and to try you. It's a purpose for that. Because everything that we're doing now, by serving God now, you're not going to receive the full credit of it now. The full credit will not be delivered unto you until Christ return. That's when you'll receive the full benefit of your suffering. There's a benefit for suffering. No, again, nobody wants to be associated with suffering, but there's a benefit to suffering. Because remember, everything that you suffer for now, it's a benefit unto you in the eternal. So he says that the verse 7, 1 and 7, that the trial of your faith, the manifold temptations that come to try you, they have been designed to try your faith, to see if your faith is anchored in Christ, to see if your faith is sure in Christ. That's why they come. They come for a purpose. Things don't happen in your life for nothing. Everything that you've gone through in your life, everything that you're going to go through in your life, the things that you're going through in your life right now, they're for a purpose. And so, oftentimes we want to run from every bad situation, but sometimes we have to stand in those bad situations to prove, one, to God that we trust in the anchor of Jesus for us, one, two, to prove to Satan that God is greater in me than you, amen, that's in my flesh. God is greater that's in me. And three, because we know that there is a reward for my suffering in the eternal. And because I know I'm greatly rejoicing, because I know that the end of my life is not in the cemetery. The end of my life is with Jesus, right? Upon his return. And so I know that when I trust in the Lord and hold on to the Lord, that I'm getting credit in the eternal with God. And you must believe that. And we can't, again, we want to live this life, this peaceful life, but you can't always live a peaceful life. Sometimes it's going to be uncomfortable. I made the analogy about being in a five-star hotel. You can go on vacation, but nothing is like your own bed. You can go and sleep in a five-star hotel on the finest sheets, but it's just something about your own bed and home. There's nothing like home. And that's what the spirit in us, that's what the spirit in us is keeping us, because the spirit in us is keeping us, because the spirit in us is making it way back home. Because what's happening is, as the spirit and the flesh are being divided, they're going to be divided. The flesh is slowly making its way back to the earth. And the spirit that's in you is keeping you. It is keeping you grounded and settled in the faith of God, amen, while your body is going back to the earth. And once your body goes back to the earth, immediately your spirit will go back to God. But when the Holy Ghost takes your spirit back to God and the work here in earth is finished and done, God takes your spirit back, and now your spirit will be accepted in the kingdom, in the eternal kingdom, because of your faith in Christ while you were here. Now, everybody's going to die, and everybody is going to sleep in God. But then there comes a time where God is going to do a separation, and we're all going to be rewarded for our work here in the earth. And this is why it's a fine line about our work. Our work is not always what we do in the physical, because sometimes people believe, because we go to church, we serve God, we go to church, we open the doors of the church, we sweep the church floors, we paint the church walls, we give to the needy, we feed the homeless. All of that is physical work. All of that is just a byproduct of who God is. That's all that is. That's a byproduct of what God is. You giving to the homeless, you feeding the homeless, you giving donations to the needy people. All of that is, again, just what God does. It's not what you do. It's what God do. But then there's a part of us, our hearts, that some people can have tough, stony hearts and do great work. It's just how it is. You have some people that have tough, stony hearts, and they'll give to the needy and give to the poor. You have some people that have hearts of hatred, malice, unforgiveness, anger, all these things because of maybe something that may have happened to them, maybe in their childhood, maybe in a relationship, maybe in the workplace, wherever. Something bad may have happened to them in their life, and their heart is set like stone, but they'll give. But God is saying, The stony heart he wants to break. He wants the stony heart to break. He wants the stony heart to be more like him and to love. So these things that, and a lot of people have stony hearts because of what happened to them. One of the manifold temptations that came in their life hurt them. And so now they have a heart of stone. But God is saying we have to take these situations that have happened in our life and use them as a benefit in your life. I was sharing with a brother the other day. I said, every day is a good day. It doesn't matter what happens. Every day is a good day when you're standing on God's beautiful earth. It's a good day. Even when the manifold temptations come, it's still a good day because it's God's day. And so when we enter into that day, thankful, right? That we're able to experience it once again, even again with the manifold temptations. So he says, the trial of your faith, it is there to try your faith. Bible said that's, you know, don't act as some strange thing has come. It's not strange. We knew it was coming. Let's see. Okay. So, look. He says that the trial of your faith in verse 7, being much more precious than of gold. The things, the manifold temptations that we're going through, they're for a purpose. God has allowed them to come to try you, right? So go to 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4, just a page over. He says, look what he says. Look what Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 4. And understanding that verse 6 and 7 is teaching us to use our sufferings in a positive way. Allow the suffering that you're going through, let it work for you in a positive way. Understand that when you overcome, that it's a benefit to you in the eternal. Even though it hurt now, even though it's rough now, it's a benefit in the eternal. When you leave this life, there's something greater that waits for you, right? So look at 1 Peter 4 and 12. Let's start at 11. So he says in verse 7, he said that the trial of your faith is much more precious. So you may say to yourself, well, how can going through can be precious for me? So he says in 1 Peter 4 and 11, he says, if any man speak, let him speak as an oracle of God. So when you speak, when you open your mouth, speak as a representative, an ambassador, as the scripture called us, of God. In other words, we really don't have time to be speaking a whole lot of other stuff out of our mouth. If it's not to build the kingdom of God, then it's really worthless and it's vain. Being in conversations that's not promoting or helping. It's really vain conversation. Sitting around talking about people business and talking about people, what they're going through. And a lot of times we'll say, well, I'm just talking to you. Or we'll just say, I'm just having a conversation. But look what the Bible says. Look what the Bible says. He says, if any man speak. You know, some will say, you know, we're not always in the spirit. That ain't what he said right here. We do know that we're not always spiritual. We're not gonna act like we always in the spirit, because we're not. We're not always in the spirit. We're not always operating in the spirit. We know this. But he was clear what he said here. He said, if any man speak, let him speak as an oracle of God. That doesn't mean you're going to be reading the word of God. That doesn't mean that you're going to be prophesying or speaking in tongue. That doesn't mean that you're going to be speaking deep in a godly way. It does not mean that, but he said what he said. If any man speak, let him speak as an oracle of God. There is no gossiping in God. There's no backbiting in God. There's no slander in God. There is no conversation about your brother or sister in God. Again, you don't have, this is not talking about, but this is talking about being in those conversations that are vain. Okay? Somebody has something going on in their life. I'm trying to help somebody. I know this for somebody. Somebody has something going on in their life and you sitting and y'all talking about it. Have I been guilty of that a million times? But I thank God for the word of God. I thank God for the word of God. And I also thank God for the spirit that he has been driving in me to keep my mouth quiet. Because a lot of times, I really find myself now not having a lot to say about stuff. Again, this is not talking about living and communicating with your family and having conversations. This is not talking about that. But if you're going to speak as an oracle of God. So if you're going to talk, let your talk be clean. If you're going to talk, let your talk be building up, because these are the things that God does. God uses his people to build up, not to tear down. He tears down. We don't have the right to tear down, because we can't tear down because we're not perfect. Only God can tear down. When things are being torn down and revealed, only God can do that. We don't have the right to tear down because none of us are perfect. We can only build up the brother because we're coming from a low place. When you're coming out of the flesh, you're coming out of a low place. Only God can tear down, because he's the only one that's high. So when we speak, we should be speaking as an oracle of God. How can we help the situation? How can we be a blessing to the situation? Because this is what the Bible teaches us as followers of Christ. To exalt your brother, to exhort your brother, to lift your brother up. But if you're going to sit and talk about your brother and tear him down about the decisions that he made in his life or the mistakes he made in his life and just talk about him to other people, you're not speaking as an oracle of God. Now we talking spiritual. Now, look, if any man minister, let him do it as of the ability with God, which God giveth. So this is both physical and spiritual here. We don't have no business talking about people, their business, and sitting around the table and just laughing and talking about people, running people down. People done had issues and problems in their life, and we don't have the right to talk about them, because all of us are going through manifold temptations and all of us have come short of the glory of God. None of us have. If we're going to speak about anything, it should be, let's pray for them. You know, they ain't had no business doing that. You know, she did this. You know, he did that. Lord, have mercy. Then we throw the Lord in there. Lord, have mercy. God, then we say, God, I'm going to pray. We shouldn't have been talking about that mess anyway. We learning about God. That was in the physical. If you're going to speak, speak as an oracle of God. Let your conversation be clean conversation. Don't pick the phone up and be talking to other people about other people. That's not as an oracle of God. And every last one of us have been guilty of that. I know sometimes people will call you and they'll begin to talk about other people. And sometimes we'll sit there and listen. The correct thing to do is, and thank you, Holy Ghost, for me, because I'm learning myself right now. The correct thing would be is, well, you know, brother or sister, they made a mistake. Let's pray for them. Let's pray that God will open their eyes and give them understanding rather than giving our 2 cents. And again, I done gave my 2 cents a million times. God, forgive me. Your humble servant, Bishop McCullough, forgive me. The man of God that you've called me to be, forgive me, God, for having these conversations. And God, teach me more how to keep my mouth silent. And to be honest with you, it'll be less talking. To be honest with you, it'll be less talking around people if you speak as an oracle of God. But then, when you operate as a minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth. When you minister to people, don't try to do something that God is not leading you to do. Don't try to do something you saw somebody else do. Don't try to minister and mimic what other people have done. Don't try to do the things that man do. He says, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth. Do it clean hearted, honestly, because that's the way God gave it to you. That God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ. People know a phony. People know when you're trying to be somebody that you're not. People know. People know. People see people minister the word of God, and some people minister the word of God. They look just like, sound just like other people. Because that's the way man gave it to you. But God is saying, don't do that. Do it as of the ability which God giveth. Why? That God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praised and dominion forever and ever. So he says that the trial of your faith, right? Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trials. A lot of people don't want to associate as children of God, don't want to associate everything good with God. Everything ain't good with God. There are some rough days with God. Everything ain't good with God, and nothing is good with God to the flesh. If we want to tell the truth, because the flesh is warring against God. If you comfortable in your flesh, and I guess that's why I'm never comfortable in my flesh now, and I guess that's why I always feel like in my flesh now, it just feels strange. Is it just me? But sometimes I just feel strange all day because of my flesh. My flesh is always like weary. And I guess it's because the fight between my flesh and my spirit. And in the past few years of my life, it has intensified, right? But God told me to think it not strange concerning the fiery trials, the things that we're going through in our life, right? And I've read this scripture 100 times or more. But I never thought I would cross the bridge where I really had to apply it to myself. But I have to apply it to myself, because manifold temptations are all around me, just like they're all around you, right? But God says, listen, the things that's going on around you, see, sometimes things are happening around us through situations that we're comfortable with, through people that we're comfortable with. But he says, listen, when these things happen, don't think of it strange. And I can honestly say some things have happened around me that I thought was strange. But he says, don't think of it strange concerning the fiery trial. It's not strange. It is to try me, just like they are to try you, just like they are to try the people that you're involved in situations with. It is to try them. What is supposed to happen is, if our anchors are sure in Christ, then we will be as a group or people or persons that are going through will be able to identify and not think of it being strange, because they and say, hey, this thing have come to try us, or this thing have come to try me. Right? He says, think it not strange concerning the fiery trials, which is to try you. They are to try us. They are not for us to make knee-jerk reactions. And that's what a lot of us do in our life. Something happens and we make this knee-jerk reaction. And sometimes the knee-jerk reaction, after you react and do certain things, later on you say, man, I kind of overreacted. And then sometimes you react and you go too far. Sometimes too far, and it's irreparable. But I am of the belief that anything that we do in a knee-jerk space, if God's still on the throne, I think that all things are repairable. That's just my faith and what I believe. I believe that nothing is too hard for God to repair. I just believe that. Have I ever made knee-jerk reactions in my life? Many times. Are there things in my life that I wish I could have a do-over with? Of course. But I don't stay in that. Because if we stay in that, then it's hard to grow out of that. When you make mistakes in your life, you got to give that to God. You got to say, God, I'm sorry. You got to give that to him and you got to let him fix it. Of course, on your end, you have to either do what's right. It may cause an action to do what's right. It may cause an apology. Whatever you have to do on your end, you do your part, right? And then let God do the rest. But then this is where patience comes in that God talks about. So he says, it's not, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. Nothing strange happened unto you because opposition came your way. Opposition was supposed to come our way. Fiery trials were supposed to come our way to try us. They were to come to try you, to make sure that your anchor is sure and that you are connected to the sure anchor, which is Jesus Christ. But then he tells us when these things happen, right? But rejoice, and as much as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering. At some point in your life when you're going through, at some point in your brokenness of your heart, you have to rejoice, because it's the same way this situation has caused you to enter into a better, more personal relationship with Christ and his experience. He said, rejoice in as much as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, Here again, this is why he tells us to gird up the loins of our hearts, minds, and to be sober, clear. Because when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. That when Christ return, we'll be happy. We'll say to ourselves, the suffering, it was all worth it. Because when Christ return, we'll be caught up to meet him. When Christ return for the fruit of the earth, we'll reign with him forever. So he says, back in 7, the trials of your faith, they are more precious than gold. What does gold do? He used the analogy of gold, right? He says gold. The trials of our faith represent the fire, right? He says, gold that perish, though it be tried with fire. Gold that comes out of the earth is impure until they purify it. Gold that comes out of the earth is impure until they purify it. Why is it impure? Because it has the remnants of the earth in it. We, children of God, are unpure, and we're being purified. We're in the fire now through the manifold temptations, which is representing the fire. We are being purified from the fragments of sin which is in this earth. And as we prove to God that we believe and we trust in him, we are being made pure like gold. So they pulled the gold out of the earth, wherever it is, wherever it was sitting, it began to take part of the elements around it, parts of the sediments, the minerals that's around it. They begin to mix with the gold. So now the value of the gold is less now, even though it is the most precious stone in the earth. But it's not as valuable as it will be after it come out that fire. Come on now. Come on now. They take that gold out of the earth and they put it in the fire and they melt it down. And as they melt it down, everything, the gold never loses its value. It never loses its substance. The substance of the gold is never lost. But everything that is in the gold is destroyed. It is burned away. This is where we talk about purifying the gold. You and I in the earth, we are the gold of God in the earth. And the sin that's in the earth has taken an abode in us. It is connected to our flesh. But the Holy Ghost in us is the fire. And it is burning, and we're not losing who we are. We are who we are. The righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's who we are. And we're not losing that. But what is happening is the fire, the Holy Ghost, is burning away the sin in us, that when we are done, when Christ is revealed, when he returns, we will be like pure gold. that had been tried in the fire. Right? So the manifold temptations that you're going through, look at them as a benefit to you. One, because they're working for you in the eternal. And the Holy Ghost in you, which is working in you, purifying you, just like the gold, purifying you. He says, fire, only what fire does, it only separates all the foreign and impure minerals from the gold. The sin in us, it's foreign. The sin that's in our heart, the bad thoughts that's in our heart, that's foreign. Now that Christ has come in, and he is our heart. He is our Lord. He is our Savior. The old thoughts that we used to think, now that we are new men, we are new creatures in Christ, old things have passed away. Behold, look, he says, look, all things have become new. So now that we are new, right? The foreign things, the sin, the adultery, the idolater, the fornication, the inordinate affection, the sin that is in the natural body, it is now foreign to me because I am a new creature, a new man, right? So now the fire, the Holy Ghost, is in me to separate me from the foreign objects that I have picked up from this world while I was in it. That's what the gold did. The longer the gold sets in the earth, the more foreign and imperfect minerals it's going to pick up. The longer it's going to take to stay in the fire to burn out those impurities, right? It loses nothing of its nature. The gold is not lost in the fire. The child of God, hallelujah, is not lost in the fire. The righteousness of God is not lost in the manifold temptation. The anchor still holds. So as we're going through trials and tribulations in our life, we're not lost. We don't lose who we are through the manifold temptations. We don't lose being the righteousness of God because we're going through trials and tribulations in our life. We don't go back and touch the unclean things that God has delivered us from. We don't go back and again be entangled with the yoke of bondage. We don't lose who we are. Because the fiery trial have come our way. And we don't begin to think that something strange has happened. But we understand that these things must happen, that I may be proven who I am in Christ Jesus. So it loses nothing. Gold has been kept in a state of fusion for months, without the smallest change. In other words, you have gone through some of the trials in your life for a long time. Some things God is just like Paul said that he prayed unto God three times. All God said to Paul was, Paul, my grace is sufficient. You've been going through the trials of your manifold temptations, and you've been praying to God and you've been asking God for deliverance, and nothing has happened. It's been a long time. And it don't seem like the smallest change is going to take place. But God said his grace is sufficient, and you should not lose who you are because nothing has changed. Because the situation hadn't gotten better. You can't lose who you are because the situation is still tough and you've been praying to God and nothing seems to be going in your direction, you steal the righteousness of God. Yes. Nothing should change because you're gold. Gold doesn't lose its value. Don't lose your value because things haven't changed. God's grace is sufficient. God's grace is sufficient. Perfection should come out of your suffering. You should be better. You shouldn't be worse coming out of suffering. Coming out of suffering, you should be better. You should be stronger. And this is what happens. This is what happens to the gold when you pull it out the fire. It's better. You put the gold in the fire, it has a lot of other minerals in it. But when you pull the gold out of the fire, it's better. When we come out of these manifold temptations, we should be better. We should be able to speak as an oracle of God when we speak and not be gossiping and talking about folk. And when we minister, we should minister under the control of the Holy Ghost and the ability that God has given us. That what? That he would be glorified and not us. Because clearly God knows what he wants to say through the vessel. So the trials that you're going through, they're precious for you. Because when you come out of that trial, you're going to be better. Why? Because you're not going to lose who you are. You're not going to forget that you are the child of the Most High God and begin to act like an ungodly child. You're going to remember that you are the righteousness of God and begin to act like a child that don't know his father. You're not going to be that way. You're going to be better. That you might be found unto praise and honor and glory. Look at verse 7. Because you didn't change, because you didn't lose who you were, and because you came out of your situations worse than you went in, when Christ appear, you're going to be found unto praise and honor. There is not time for us to be praise and honor. Some of us want our praises and our honor too soon. Right now is for Jesus to be praised and honored. Why? Because he was the first that was risen from the dead. He was the first. So he deserves the glory and the honor right now. Our honor is not to be acknowledged yet. This is Christ's time to be honored. We are to honor Christ because he has already risen from the grave. But then when he come and we raise a being risen from the grave out of the dead, just as he was, right? Then we'll be praised with honor and glory. And can't nobody do it for us but Jesus. When Jesus comes, Jesus is going to praise us with honor and glory in his return. But right now we are to praise him with honor and glory. There's going to come a time when Jesus is going to come and give you your praises and give you your honor and give you your flowers and your glory. But that's got to be in his return, not now. It's his turn right now. We'll get ours at the appearing of Jesus Christ. So don't look for man to praise you. It's not time yet. Don't look to be recognized and exalted right now. It's not time yet. Right now is Jesus' time for him to be praised and for him to be honored because he has already gotten up from the grave. But when we get up from the grave, then he's going to praise us and honor us and bring us back home with the Father. This is the Bishop's Desk. I pray that it was a blessing to you. I pray that you have a great day. Next week, we're going to go into verse 8 and 9. Whom having not seen, ye love, and whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of joy, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. for present unspeakable joy and salvation we see here. And so we'll go into verse 8 and 9 on next week. I pray that this was a blessing to you. And remember, the trials of your faith, think it not strange that these things are happening to you. Know that the trials of your faith, they are working for you in the eternal. And by you going through the trials of your faith and the manifold temptations of life, that you have been acquainted as a partaker in Christ's suffering. This is the Bishop's Dust. God bless you, and I love you.